Hi guys, Jonathan Graham here for Guitar Interactive Magazine. We are here with the one and only Wolfgang Van Halen. How are you doing, buddy?
I'm doing good. Thanks for having me.
Now, this is a very special location we've got right here with quite a few toys that we'll show you in just a little bit. But you were here yesterday giving us a sneak preview of a couple of tracks from Mammoth 2 in an acoustic fashion, which was absolutely fantastic. You know, so many things to talk about, but first of all, just talking on the new record. When we spoke last at the O2, you did let us into a little bit of information that, you know, the work had started on the record. You couldn't say too much about it. Now that it's complete, I've got to hear it. It's fantastic, by the way.
Thank you.
You must feel relieved to get over the second record, because the second one's always difficult, isn't it?
Yeah, it's always that you want to avoid that sophomore slump, the sort of thing that everybody expects of a second album. And I guess as a fan of the material, and you know, I think you should be as you're making it. You know, I kind of follow what I enjoy. I think we avoided it.
Yeah. Well, you know, you were, I mean, I think we kind of touched on it last time we spoke, but you know, you were in that unique position where sometimes when people have got a first record coming out, that's their introduction to the world. Mm-hmm. And of course it was for a lot of people, you know, in terms of all that different side to what you're all about, but you know, a lot of people were very familiar with your work beforehand. Mm-hmm. With the second record, that poses a almost in a different way. It could potentially be, you know, easier than the follow-up, because actually was a little bit the pressure off a little bit more for you now that people know what you're all about, know the stuff that you're into, that you could just sort of switch off, put the fans to one side for a second and just carry on doing what you want to do?
Yeah, certainly. I felt that I came into the process with a bit more confidence after, you know, touring for the last 2 years and kind of establishing who and what I am and what Mammoth is. So I think I kind of let loose a bit and had a bit more fun and allowed myself to kind of do stuff that I didn't think I would have been capable or would have done on the first album.
Of course. Now, the album has got incredible moments all the way throughout it. And of course, we're a guitar magazine, so I'm going to be focusing a little bit on some of the playing that's going on in there. And man, I mean, you must have, well, I don't think you feel the pressure, because my God, we've seen you in incredible high pressure moments and you fucking delivered. But man, Take a Bow is quite a statement.
Yeah, I think that moment when I came up with it was like, okay, this is one of those evolutions where it's like, okay, this was not on the first album. And this is a new side of, I think, myself that you start to kind of unravel and see as time goes on. And that's a really special moment. I think it's one of the more special things I think I've recorded with Mammoth. So I'm very excited for people to hear it.
Yeah, congratulations on it. It's fantastic. Can you talk us through like some of the tones that you use, but in particular on that record, what were you using?
Specifically that record, the entire backbone of that entire record is my, it was the third prototype. It's the Tobacco Sunburst SA-126. Mm. And I play it through my 50 watt 6L6 5153 through the 412 cabinet, and it's the same head and cabinet that I played at the Wembley Taylor Hawkins tribute show and the Los Angeles show, but because I played it at Wembley first, we put tape on it and I named the amp and the cabinet. The amp's name is Noel and the cab's name is Liam. I just thought that was a funny little Oasis joke.
Yeah, sure. Are you a fan then?
Yeah. I've always dug Oasis. Yeah. Big fan of High Flying Birds and stuff like that.
So. Yeah, that's killer, man. That nice little tip. So that could be, in some ways, it could be the, you know, the early Wolfgang signature sound then.
Yeah. That's the thing, is that it really is, I think it's a very great demonstration of what the SA-126 is capable of. Mm. It has that warmer, semi-hollow tone, but then you hear the solos and it's high octane, shreddy, buttery smooth. You know, the neck is thick and wide, or thin and wide, and but even the cleans, like the start of Take a Bow, that clean, that's the SA-126.
It's all just to sit.
It's
incredible,
very dynamic.
It really is, and I think that's the thing as a listener, you know. You're taken through, you know, a sort of a journey with the track, obviously, but like tonally as well. When something's like a really authentic, almost like analog A type thing, you feel like that sort of human connection to it. Just to talk a little bit on the structure of the actual solo itself, because it's such a masterful moment on there. was there a lot of improvisation involved in there? Was it one that you sort of crafted out?
Yeah, when it comes to solos, I treat them as like little songs. They're something that I craft out. I don't think I'm a strong enough improvisational player to pull something off like that off the cuff. I definitely like to craft something start to finish, so it kind of flows and tells its own little story. But yeah, it was funny. I basically just set the main riff on my computer on repeat, and I just kind of jammed to it for like hours and hours, and ended up crafting all the best bits that I came up with, you know, into that solo. But I think the most fun little detail about that, in terms of tone and everything, is that it was the one moment that I recorded on the album with my dad's original Frankenstein guitar, and not just the guitar, but also the original Marshall head that he used for the original Van Halen albums, and one of the original cabs. So it was basically everything he used for those original classic albums.
Wow, okay.
And you can hear that on certain bends. You know, it's kind of crazy. There's certain notes where it's like, wow, that literally sounds like Van Halen 1. It's crazy.
I think what's especially crazy is that, you know, as people get to hear it, people will react to that and not really know. I mean, I didn't know that, but, you know, fans and, you know, guitar connoisseurs or whatever, you know, they're going to react to moments there. And although your playing is solid throughout and the tracks are all great, it's funny how there'll be certain things that without even realizing it, something's twigging something in your mind, you know. I mean, that's very, very cool, because when we spoke as well before, you know, I was being cheeky and asking, you know, could we see, you know, Alex dropping in for something or whatever on the record? And you said at the time, you said, look, if one of the guys from one of the other bands was going to do something, they might do it, but you wouldn't know they would do it because I'd have them playing a triangle or I'd have them something like that. Is there some Easter eggs on there that maybe 5 years down the line someone would realize that it's there?
Not really. The one thing like that that I did do was just out of a fun little joke. The song I'm All Right for that solo with the wah. When I was writing it, while we were playing it and just kind of going through, taking different takes and stuff. And I kind of got bored with the operation of it, so I had my Uncle Patrick, who was in the studio. He's always just kind of hanging out. He's been an important part of the Mammoth team.
Of course.
I just had him do it. So on the album, you'll see on the back of the album, it says all songs recorded and performed, or written and performed by Wolfgang Van Halen, except for wah operation on solo of I'm All Right by Patrick Bertinelli.
I like that.
And while I thought it was a funny joke initially, just to be really strict on the crediting of that, it actually held back the approval process for the album cover by one day, because we had to sign a work for hire and pay him $1 so he could legally have it there. So my manager was a bit upset with me for that dumb joke, but I thought it was pretty funny.
I do, you know, and I do respect the fact you didn't go for the whole, you know, PR clickbait of saying my uncle is on this record.
Well, I so badly wanted to do that at one point with Dad, but have him play like piano or cello or, you know, something where it wasn't guitar.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, it makes sense.
I'll have to have Al play the Glockenspiel on the track or something.
So, you know, throughout the track, you know, as I say, it's a real evolution in terms of like the songwriting, your vocal performances, everything is, you know, I really did love it from start to finish. From the, again, to focus just a little bit more on the playing, what I was finding was, obviously you're your own guy, you've got your own sound and that's still developing, but it was interesting to hear, you know, like the Steve Lukather elements in your playing, even maybe like the elements of Joe Satriani vibes and stuff like that. Players like this had a big influence on you as well as your dad.
Yeah, no, it's funny, like I think I've been almost more influenced by guitar players who are influenced by them than themselves, although I have known Luke like my whole life, so I'm sure that's a part of just kind of being around that. But I think guitar players like Aaron Marshall from Intervals, who are super influenced by, or like Pliny, who are super influenced by them. I'm influenced by them from that perspective. So yeah, it's kind of just this kind of amalgamation of all that, for sure.
It's just, it's, you know, especially these days, you know, you get a lot of players and, you know, they might be able to do something real fast or flashy or whatever, but there's just this sort of locking into the groove that not everyone can do. I mean, obviously, guys like yourself do it. Nuno, you know, does it for till the cows come home. But we're seeing fewer and fewer of these types of players.
I think a lot of my playing just in every aspect is most importantly rooted in rhythm and melody.
Yeah, of course. No, that makes sure. Now, to do that, of course, you need some fantastic instruments. We talked about a couple that are on the record there. What have we got sitting with us here? Because these are some pretty special instruments.
Yeah, this is just the Stealth 5150 series. And here we've got the old Wolfgang Special. It's like a almost marshmallowy seafoam. And I was just enjoying playing it before you got here.
Now, do you like to swap out, you know, what? Because we see you a lot with you know, similar rig on the tours and stuff like that. You know, did these ever make it to the shows? You ever?
I did actually play this one for a bit for certain songs, but overall, I've been having a wonderful time crash testing the SA-126.
Yeah, killer, fantastic. Now, yesterday, as you know, I'd mentioned, you were doing this fantastic stripped down acoustic versions of the tracks. Now, after you performed it, you know, I came over and I was saying, man, it was fantastic. And it was great to see that different side of you. But one thing that I also noticed was just before we were sort of kicking things off, you know, it almost looked like there was a slight bit of nerves, you know, before you got. Now, it was just us and, like, you know, 10 people around. Now, you've obviously played in front of millions of people and, you know, around the world. And, you know, you've done all sorts of shows. But before a performance, is there still an element of nerves? Is that something that you like to use?
Yeah. Oh, I'm certainly, that's something you need to figure out how to harness before every show. But I feel like if I wasn't nervous, I wouldn't care.
Yeah.
I think that's just a result of maybe my perfectionism, which might not be a good thing. But I think just that desire to play and perform the best I can, I think, is always there. Also, I think it's probably more nerve-wracking playing for a room of 15 people than 15,000 people, because you can just kind of go cross-eyed when you see that many people. But when you can see every single person,
that's it.
It's a bit more nerve-wracking,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. I can definitely imagine. But that type of stripped-down version of the tracks, because they really breathed, and clearly that was even maybe how some of the, you know, sometimes you could be writing tracks like that, could start in that and then evolve into that.
Yeah, usually I write my ideas on an acoustic guitar, so that's usually how it starts.
Oh, brilliant. Kind of, so. Yeah, because, you know, you felt that there. Is that, you know, something that you would like to show in a live set and like that, where you have a moment in the show where you strip it down?
Yeah, that'd be a lot of fun. I know out of necessity, because there were two members of our band that weren't with us for three shows, I played Distance by myself acoustically, which is how I wrote it, and it was actually really special. So it might be fun to return to that idea at some point for a live setting.
Now, with the new record with Mammoth 2, all done in 5150, I'm assuming.
Yeah.
Why
would
you go anywhere else?
Yeah, no, there's, you know, it's my job to make music there for the rest of my life, and that's what I plan on doing.
What was the first thing you recorded in there?
No,
just ever.
Oh, man. I think when I was in, when I was in fifth grade, I had to record. So there was this thing at my elementary school called the cell wraps.
Right.
Which was, you had to, I can't believe I'm talking about this. Basically, it was like a performance where you got with classmates and you'd have to sing a song that had to do with science and the cell. And I, with one of my friends, Nick, and the help of my dad, with a karaoke file of the song Pop by NSYNC, recorded vocals about cells for that song. And I think that was the very first thing I recorded at 5150.
And that'll still be there.
Yeah. I'd have to find the tape of it or the CD of it, but Dad was always, it was funny, even then, I was so embarrassed by it, but even then, Dad was always saying, like, listen to your voice, it's badass. So he always had faith in me to be the singer that I am today. Singing for, you know, lead for something.
Well, if Cells doesn't come out as a bonus track, I think you're definitely robbing the world.
I would really need to find that, because that would be some funny content for everybody on social media.
Yeah,
maybe it shouldn't be out there. I don't know. Well, I'll have to find.
Well, I don't know with these fans, man. You know, it's 50-50. I mean, now I think what's great is on this second cycle now, I think you've really culled away the people that are wanting the Panama covers. You know, the
Certainly.
Unchained coming out.
Yeah,
you know, people that are sticking around now, they're in it because
yeah,
fans
no, it's
of you.
It's wonderful to see, and very humbling that people find merit in what I'm doing on my own. It's wonderful.
So. And of course, you know, it's always going to be something that is, when we're talking 5150, you know, it's like a treasure trove. I mean, there's got to be so many things in there that have been recorded over the years that you've done, that your dad's done, that Gary Sharon's done. You know, maybe we can't talk about that. But, you know, are there, there's got to be, I think I already know the answer, but I mean, are there some things in there that fans would just be mind blown to know that, that
I'm sure. I mean, there's so much history there, but you know, in the grand scheme of things, the stuff that was ready to be heard has been.
Yeah.
All that stuff is stuff that kind of hit the cutting room floor.
Yeah.
So when it comes to decision making on if there's anything worth being released, that's definitely in Al's court, because he's sort of the purveyor and leader on everything Van Halen. I'm kind of just there to help him out.
And I'm not going to push on Van Halen anymore, but just one final thing, because I really would regret not asking, especially when we're bringing up Al. Obviously, when I saw you last, you know, it wasn't that long after you'd done the Taylor thing.
Mm-hmm.
Incredible. Jeff Beck this week's just had the tribute show. We know there's been all the rumors. I spoke to Joe Satriani about it. You know, Mikey's talked about it, all sorts. It never happened for one reason or the next. At this stage, is this still something that you would like to happen? Or do you think the moment's passed?
In another universe, yeah, absolutely something I'd like to happen. But unfortunately, in this one, I don't think it's possible.
Okay, fair enough. Now, you're going to be playing Download in just a couple of days. This will be your first time, I think, at the Download Festival.
I've been looking forward to playing Download. Before Download was a thing, I remember my dad telling me about Donington and hearing about just the magic. That's where Monsters Rock happens.
Of course.
So it's just, I've my whole life, I think I've been looking forward to this. So I'm very, very excited.
Set list for a show like that for Download when it's a festival, how does that differ from you when it's a solo gig?
I think for something like that, it's kind of like what we're doing with Metallica, where we kind of steer our set to the high octane sort of aggressive songs to kind of get everybody moving. I feel like if you start to play some like slow acoustic song, that might not be something everybody's ready to rock out to.
Yeah.
So we'll see. I'm looking forward to it.
Well, I do remember like a few years back at Sonosphere, which was another festival, a metal festival that used to go on in the UK, Nine Inch Nails, one year, they did decide just to play just all the slowest tracks possible. But that, I think that was just a troll, which again, seeing sometimes the you know, your Facebook, your social media interactions, I could see that down the line as well.
I'm not about to troll something I've been looking forward to for
no,
this long.
That makes sense.
I'm going to make every ounce of it count.
Yeah, and I'll be looking forward to seeing it. Now, you did touch on the fact that you've been out on the road with Metallica. How are those guys to play with?
Oh, man, it's absolutely crazy. It's an honor to be a part of something so mammoth.
Yeah.
You know, it's crazy. The stage is very unique. It's unlike anything I've ever taken part in before, so it's very exciting. They're super wonderful and they've been so kind to us. It's awesome.
And have you had a chance to play Greenie yet?
No, I have not. I'll have to talk to Kirk and see if I can maybe look at it.
yeah, for sure. Now, Mammoth 2 comes out in August. We've got to hear, well, you know, like I was saying, we've been lucky enough to hear the record ahead of time. But fans, so far, you know, there's a couple of bits that have come out and they've been very well received. What's the next single?
I think I'm not sure. I know there's talks of... Because, you know, the way you work up albums, there's always, like, I think we might get one more track out before the album drops.
Mm.
But I'm not 100% sure what that is yet.
Because that's the thing. It you know, you almost do feel these days that is it as important, you know, the single releases, the music videos, the way people consume stuff, you know, is very different these days. But I was just really curious because... Obviously, it's pretty solid start to end, so it's difficult making that decision.
Yeah, it's tough trying to figure out what the official early what the lead single when the album comes out is going to be. I think we're still figuring that out.
And where did the album start? Like, what was the first track that you finished?
The first track, I think we started recording on drums. I think the first song I did on drums was Another Celebration.
Okay.
But the first song I sung vocally that we got to hear complete was Like a Pastime.
Beautiful, yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, obviously I managed to take a bow before, but like Optimist as well, I love that middle section of the record. But you know, I'm just, you know, getting to hear it the first few times, and it's one of those ones that after you hear it 2, 3, 4 different tracks pop out, different things happen.
What's great is that it doesn't overstay its welcome either. It's a quick, you know, 48 minute, you know, song album, so as you just or 10 song album, so it's easy to listen to it again after you
of course it. no for sure. So with that, you know, as I was mentioning about, you know, how when you're listening to these tracks more, different ones can sort of pop out, is there an album like that in your collection that, you know, the first time you heard it, it was X, Y, and Z were the tracks, but after living with it for 10-15 years, you know, actually these are my favorites?
Wow. I mean, I'm not sure. I have a more recent example for like maybe a couple years is this album Circadian by Intervals. Mm. Like initially the first song on the album, I was like, this is like the greatest thing ever. But then as it rolls, you start to listen, you're like, wait, no, every single song on this album is perfect.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's one of my favorite albums of all time.
Awesome, awesome. Well, look, Wolf, thanks so much for taking some time again to talk with us. And enjoy downloading. Congratulations on the record.
Thank you so much.